I can't help but feel like I've seen you before. Howdy, hey there, and hello. I'm Montez McCrary at TezoNerdo from thepractitioner.com. And on this architecture themed episode of Practitioner Documented or Docked, you know the drill by now. We'll be discussing the iconic Farnsworth House, designed by legendary architect Ludwig Mies van der Rohe. It's a lot more easier to set up videos when everything's just right there. And all this magic can be taken care of in post. Woo! Now, let's get nerdy. Ludwig Mies van der Rohe was retained by Dr. Edith Farnsworth to design a weekend retreat during a dinner party back in 1945. Now, Mies operated as the architect and the contractor for the project, and work began in 1950 and was mostly completed in 1951. But while this commission was ideal for any architect, it was marred by a very publicized dispute between Farnsworth and Mies that began near the end of construction, as the house was more than $15,000 over budget. Lawsuits of non-payment and malpractice, etc. Mies won the suits as Farnsworth signed the plan and budget increase contracts in the first place. But the victory was bitter and hollow for Mies, considering the painful publicity that followed, including the unfinished site and the home's unfinished interiors. Additional projects like the teak wardrobe closet and the bronze-framed screen porch were completed by Mies' former employee and architect William Dunlap and a local millworker who mediated between them, as Mies never spoke to or about with Edith Farnsworth, including anything regarding a rumored relationship between the two. Edith continued to use the house as her weekend retreat for the next 21 years, then sold it to British property magnate, art collector, and architectural aficionado Peter Palumbo. And in 2003, the Friends of the Farnsworth House, National Trust for Historic Preservation, and Landmarks Illinois purchased the house in 2003 for reportedly $7.5 million. Now operated as a house museum, the Farnsworth House is open to the public, with tours conducted by the National Trust, and is listed in the National Register, and it's designated a National Historic Landmark by the United States Department of the Interior. Mies stated, "Nature too shall live its own life. We must beware not to disrupt it with the color of our houses and interior fittings, yet we should attempt to bring nature, houses, and human beings together into a higher unity." And how did he do that, you ask? The clear floor-to-ceiling glass really opens the interior to its natural surroundings, while two distinctive horizontal slabs with edges refined by the exposed steel structural members painted in white do a good job in forming the roof and floor that sandwich an open space for living. The house is elevated 5'3" above a floodplain by 8 wide-flanged steel columns attached to the sides of the floor and ceiling slabs that extend beyond the column supports, creating cantilevers, while a third floating slab acts as an attached terrace that transitions between the living area and the ground. So the house is accessed by two sets of wide steps connecting ground to terrace and then to the porch. These design decisions allow the interior to blend with the exterior as nature and natural light flow into the space, creating an aura solidifying the harmony between the inner and outer worlds without the needs for elements of landscape or garden-related architecture. Mies applied a open exhibition hall style to the house for flexible use, as the interior appears to be a single room that flows around two cores, one smaller core containing the wardrobe closet and the other larger core containing a kitchen, an enclosed toilet, and fireplace, which seems like a separate house nesting within the larger glass house itself. Like Russian nesting dolls. While areas for sleeping, cooking, dressing, eating, and sitting were implied rather than dictated based on subtle differentiations within the open space itself, the house included an option to install curtain tracks that would allow privacy separations of the open spaces into three rooms, but originally the drapery was never installed because for reasons mentioned earlier, the whole suit. Stuff just didn't get done. With the use of a single open and flexible room that can accommodate changing uses, zero interior supports, glass enclosures with minimal exterior structural framing support, the Farnsworth House is significant as Mises' first complete realization of his ideal, this prototype, this vision of what modern architecture in that era of any new advancing technology could be. Despite anti-modernist criticisms, the Farnsworth House continued to receive wide critical acclaim as a modernist masterpiece, as Mises went on to receive the Presidential Medal of Honor for his contributions to American architecture and culture. I mean, heck, it even inspired architect and critic Philip Johnson to build his own glass house in 1947. And why all this praise? Well, the Farnsworth House has a timeless quality reflected by the fascination in the minimalist house that's now being seen in the works of this new generation of design professionals and enthusiasts. Trust me, it's everywhere, from dead ringer lookalikes to even the concept of tiny house living and tiny home living. Minimalist culture is out there and it's all over the place. The Illinois Institute of Technology, or IIT, announced in 2011 that they were going to build a permanent exhibition space for the huge wardrobe that was formerly in the house, mainly due to the damage done to the wardrobe during the floods in 1996, and 1998, and in 2008. Yeesh. IIT students under the direction of Professor Frank Fleury have been involved in the design and construction of the structure, nicknamed by the students as the Barnsworth, and the wardrobe will be in a better protected place for future visitors because it'll be well above the 500-year floodplain level that the house is in. And it's scheduled to be completed in September 2012, or it was scheduled to be completed in September 2012. Green screen, is it done? Thank you. In 2013, LEGO Architecture Series produced a model of the Farnsworth House as part of their Landmark Architecture Series. And this year, in 2016, the movie Batman vs. Superman Dawn of Justice featured a basement under the Farnsworth House as being one of the hideouts and central command centers of Batman, while the house itself served as a retreat house for his alter ego, Bruce Wayne. So, there's something interesting about that movie. Maybe when you go back and see it, a lot of you are not going to go back and see it. Poor DC. I'm waiting for that R-rated release, though. I'm looking forward to that.